Born in Dublin in 1854 of cultured and well-to-do Irish parents, Oscar Wilde spent his early youth in his native country. For 3 years, he attended Trinity College in Dublin, but completed his university education at Oxford, where he devoted himself to classical studies. After traveling in Italy and Greece, he came to London. His first book was a volume of poems. These were followed by his first play, Zara or the Nihilist, which was performed in the United States in 1883. The Duchess of Padua, a verse tragedy, was performed in the United States in 1891. Meantime, Wilde had been in Paris, there making the acquaintance of many prominent literary men of the period. In 1884, he married and was enabled thereby, as his wife was a woman of means, to devote his time to lecturing, writing poetry, essays, stories, and plays. The important plays, Lady Windermere's Fan, A Woman of No Importance, An Ideal Husband, and The Importance of Being Earnest, were produced between 1892 and 1895. In 1895, Wilde was sentenced to 2 years imprisonment with hard labor as a result of a trial instigated by him against the Marquess of Queensberry. On leaving prison, he adopted the name of Sebastian Melmoth and went to France. There and at Naples, where he later went and wrote The Ballad of Reading Gaul, he dragged out the few remaining years of his life. He died at Paris on November 30, 1900 because of cerebral meningitis.
She said that she would dance with me if I bought her red roses. But in all my garden there is no red rose. No red rose in all my garden. On what little things does happiness depend? I have read all the wise men have written, and all the secrets of philosophy are mine. Yet for want of a red rose is my life made wretched.
Here at last is a true lover. Night after night have I sing of him, though I knew him not. Night after night have I told his story to the stars, and now I see him. His hair is dark as the hyacinth's blossom, and his lips are red as the rose of his desire. But passion has made his face like pale ivory, and sorrow has set his seal upon his brow.
The prince gives a ball tomorrow night, and my love will be of the company. If I bring her a red rose, she will dance with me till dawn. If I bring her a red rose, I shall hold her in my arms, and she will lean her head upon my shoulder, and her hand will be clasped in mine. But there is no red rose in my garden, so I shall sit lonely, and she will pass me by. She will have no heed of me, and my heart will break.
Here indeed is a true lover. What I think of his sufferings, what is joy to me, to him is pain. Surely, love is a wonderful thing. It is more precious than emeralds, and dearer than fine opals. Pearls and pomegranates cannot buy it, nor is it set forth in the marketplace. It may not be purchased of the merchant, nor can it be weighed out in the balance for gold.
The musicians will sit in the gallery and play upon their stringed instruments, and my love will dance to the sound of the harp and the violin. She will dance so lightly that her feet will not touch the floor, and the courtiers in their gray dresses will throng round her. But with me she will not dance, for I have no red rose to give her.
Why is he weeping?
Why indeed? Why indeed?
He is weeping for a red rose.
For a red rose?
How very ridiculous! Give me a red rose, and I will sing you my sweetest song.
My roses are white as the foam of the sea, and whiter than the snow upon the mountain. But go to my brother who goes beneath the student's window, and perhaps he will give you what you want.
Give me a red rose, and I will sing you my sweetest song.
My roses are red as the feet of the dove, and redder than the great fans of coral that wave and wave in the ocean cavern. But the winter has chilled my veins, and the frost has nipped my buds, and the storm has broken my branches, and I shall have no roses at all this year.
One red rose is all I want. Only one red rose. Is there no way by which I can get it?
There is a way, but it is so terrible that I dare not to tell it to you.
Tell it to me. I am not afraid.
If you want a red rose, you must build it out of music by moonlight and stain it with your own heart's blood. You must sing to me with your breast against a thorn. All night long you must sing to me, and the thorn must pierce your heart, and your lifeblood must flow into my veins and become mine.
Death is a great price to pay for a red rose, and life is very dear at all. It is pleasant to sit in the green wood and to watch the sun in his chariot of gold and the moon in her chariot of pearl. Sweet is the scent of the hawthorn, and sweet are the bluebells that hide in the valley and the heather that grows on the hill. Yet love is better than life, and what is the heart of a bird compared to the heart of a man?
Be happy. You shall have your red rose. I will build it out of music by moonlight and stain it with my own heart's blood. All that I ask of you in return is that you will be a true lover, for love is wiser than philosophy, though she is wise, and mightier than power, though he is mighty. Flame-colored are his wings, and colored like flame is his body. His lips are sweet as honey, and his breath is like frankincense.
Sing me one last song. I shall feel very lonely when you are gone.
She has form that cannot be denied to her. But has she got feeling? I am afraid not. In fact, she is like most artists. She is all style, without any sincerity. She would not sacrifice herself for others. She thinks merely of music, and everybody knows that the arts are selfish. Still, it must be admitted that she has some beautiful notes in her voice. What a pity it is that they do not mean anything or do any practical good.
And when the moon shone in the heavens, the nightingale flew to the rose tree and set her breast against the thorn. All night long she sang with her breast against the thorn, and the cold crystal moon leaned down and listened. All night long she sang, and the thorn went deeper and deeper into her breast, and her life blood ebbed away from her. She sang first of the birth of love in the hearts of a boy and a girl. And on the top of the most spray of the rose tree, there blossomed a marvelous rose, petal following petal, a song followed song. Pale was it at first, as the mist that hangs over the river pale at the feet of the morning, and silver as the wings of dawn, as the shadow of the rose in a mirror of silver, as the shadow of a rose in a water pool, so was the rose that blossoms on the topmost spray of the tree.
Press closer, little nightingale, or the day will come before the rose is finished.
Look, look, the rose is finished now.
Why, what a wonderful piece of luck! Here is a red rose. I have never seen any rose like it in all my life. It is so beautiful that I am sure it has a long Latin name.
You say said that you would dance with me if I bought you red roses. Here is the reddest rose in all the world. You will wear it tonight next to your heart, and as we dance together, it will tell you how I love you.
I am afraid it will not go with my dress, and besides, the chamberlain's nephew has sent me some real jewels, and everybody knows that jewels cost far, far more than flowers.
Well, upon my word, you are very ungrateful.
Ungrateful? I tell you what, you are very rude. And after all, who are you? Only a student. Why? I don't believe you have even got silver buckles to your shoes, as the chamberlain's nephew has.
What a silly thing love is. It is not half as useful as logic, for it does not prove anything, and it is always telling one of things that are not going to happen, and making one believe things that are not true. In fact, it is quite impractical, and as in this age, to be practical is everything. I shall go back to philosophy and study this.